reuse this cone, so he just wanna extend that and stretch it.
Yes, HTML, yeah, it'll take.
No.
I would like to call to order this Tuesday, April 11th, Finance Committee meeting of the Parish of Ascension. Thank you all for being here this evening. We look forward to an interesting night. I'm gonna be prayerful that we get out of here before 10 o'clock. Last night, it was 10 o'clock. So let's see if we can do better than that.
Well, finance might, but utilities may not.
Well, that's y'all's problem. Okay, so thank you, everybody, for being here. At this time, I'd like to invite Ken Dawson to lead us in a prayer to be followed by the pledge. If you'll stand and remain standing.
Let us pray. Father, we thank you again for the opportunity to be here, and especially during this season where we celebrate and understand the death and resurrection of your Son. For you said in your word that whosoever shall believe, O God, that we will be saved and have eternal life. And Father, as we come, we recognize that. We pray for the people of Ascension Parish. We ask that you continue to touch them. Continue, O God, to unite us as a community. Because your word also says a house divided against itself would not stand. So as we come today, we thank you, O God, for unity in mind, body, and spirit. Unity, O God, for the purpose of Ascension Parish. Unity, O God, to propel the projects forward and to assist in moving the values, O God, and commitment and the purpose for the people of this parish as we continue to work together in unity and in oneness. We thank you for all the things you continually do and the blessing that you continually bestow upon this parish, and we give you thanks in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
There will be no chairs additions this afternoon. However, there will be one item removed from the agenda. We're going to pull item number 9. And I would also like to advise that if there is an item on the agenda about which you would like to speak, please get with the secretary, fill out a comment card. You will be called on at the appropriate time, and you will have 3 minutes to address the council and the audience. Thank you for your participation in that. Item number 5, under the general business of the Finance Committee, Ascension Economic Development Corporation's quarterly report to be presented tonight for the first time by Kate MacArthur, the new president and CEO of Ascension Economic Development, and she will be joined by Lisa Laws, who is her project manager. Kate, welcome.
Thank
we look
you.
Forward to having you with us quarterly and on any special occasion that you might have for years to come.
Well, good. Thank you so much. I'm glad to be here tonight and do a really quick background for those of you that I have not had the pleasure to sit down and meet with yet. I have been in this position for 3 weeks now, and it has been a wonderful 3 weeks, and I want to thank Lisa for helping me as much as she has right now and kind of keeping things going. Also, I have been practicing economic development here in the Baton Rouge area for 11 years, and in total I've been practicing for 14 years since receiving my master's in economic development from the University of Southern Mississippi. So I just wanted you guys to know a little bit about me. I want to thank you all for letting us present again tonight, and hopefully I will have a lot of really great news as we continue presenting to you. Right now, you have our current prospect list in front of you. We are working with 5 major projects at the moment. We consider those A projects. They represent $13 billion of potential investment in our parish and 734 new jobs. We have 16 B and C level projects, which are ones that may have been active projects at one time and may have had a stall in activity. So we still are working those as they come up and move around in our project chart. But overall, we have over $30 billion of project activity, and it has been a very exciting 3 weeks of new project activity coming online as well. So I look forward to having some announcements this year. We are continuing with our program of work, and business retention and expansion is one of our major factors in our program of work. Lisa and I have been visiting with many companies here, and year-to-date we have met with 14 companies. We do this to kind of help them with anything that they may need and to discover if they are investing any more in the parish or if we can assist them with creating some more jobs. And in these 14 interviews, we have uncovered two potential expansion projects, and those would create $90 million of new investment and 10 new jobs. So a lot of these companies have been recognized by many organizations for their records and safety, which we are really excited about. And at least one of them is having a 50-year celebration this year, so we're glad that they have been in Ascension Parish for over 50 years after this year. One of the things that we do talk about are their issues that are coming up, and there has been a lot of talk about tax uncertainty and transportation issues, and so we are really trying to work through those and stay abreast of what's going on in the legislative session and with the new tax reform to try and alleviate the concerns that they're expressing right now. We've also been working on our Riverplex Megapart site. We have a 17,000-acre site on the west side that we have been promoting and have gotten a lot of traction on recently, so we'll be continuing to look at a marketing plan for that site and see how we can further diversify our existing businesses and really get that promoted on a international level. We are still working with our existing firms a lot through our business retention and expansion visits, and that's to see if there can be any co-location opportunities that would help our existing industries and really add value to the parish. And then we continue to communicate our work to stakeholders and allies, and we are still publishing a quarterly newsletter, which I hope you're all receiving. One of our big items is the industrial tax exemption program, and I know that at our last briefing we spoke about that to you and the changes that came about in the executive order from the governor. That is still a very important and timely issue at this moment, so we will be meeting with all of you again to talk about getting a local resolution for the ITEP program. In front of you lists the changes. It's the same changes that were brought up at the last meeting as far as getting that local resolution. We do have some projects that are concerned about the status of the ITEP right now that are in the works for this year and immediately in the 6 months wondering what that status is going to be. So we are actively trying to get a resolution on the local level. So I'm sure I will be back before our next report to talk about the ITEP a little bit further. And to close it out, we are still doing our agency reporting, including this meeting. We have met with the administration twice, and we'll have one more tomorrow. We have our 2016 financial review underway, and we are going to be assisting with the implementation of the Ascension Small Business Power Week coming up in August. So if you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer. I'm sure Lisa can help if I don't know the answers at this moment, but feel free to ask anything you want to know.
Sure, gentlemen.
Ma'am.
Councilman Dawson.
Well, thank you. I don't really have a question, Kate, but I wanted to welcome you to the council chambers. And we look forward to working with you, as we said earlier, for many years to come. As Councilwoman Casso said, know you and Lisa and Misty will make a great team for us. And we look forward to you standing here and making an announcement on the 17,000-acre site.
I look forward to that, too.
That'll get you the front page of a magazine somewhere.
Hey, I don't even need to be on the cover. I just need it to happen.
Yes, indeed. Any others? I see several questions. By the way, somebody up here should tell you that you're much better looking than the last AEDC president. But since they were, well, far too gentlemanly, I'll do it for them. They're all thinking it.
Better than come from a woman.
Well, you're all thinking it. Councilman Clua.
Yeah. Kate, thank you. Welcome aboard as usual. And you've inherited one of the best staffs around. I'm going to be honest with you. These guys, they do it. I guess one of the things that, you know, as we look at economic development, one of the things that has been hovering over our heads, the dark cloud, possibly based on our tax base in Ascension Parish, is the industrial tax exemption. We've seen some strong messages come out within the last year out, you know, from Baton Rouge. And so, you know, just the pushback that we've had and trying to clarify some of the statements. And I just want to let you know that please come forward to us with whatever we need. That's within fairness.
That's our goal.
To keep it moving. We have a lot of good things on the economic horizon, still in Ascension. And we can hope that they'll clean up the finances in Baton Rouge and not just push it straight down to the parish level. Thank you.
Mr. Cagnon.
Okay, welcome. Also, I look forward to serving with you on the board. ITEP is going to be very important. That's probably the key issue addressing us the rest of this year. And hopefully this session will iron out some of the differences. I did a bill review this morning with the chemical industry, and it was kind of hectic. But the other thing is I think we probably have the only mega site of that size in the state, if I'm not, I don't know if Texas or Mississippi or Alabama do, but I look forward to you promoting that and getting us a good tenant.
Good.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Hearing none, we thank you again for being here and for bringing your sidekick. And we'll see you next time.
Thank you.
Thank you. At this time, I will ask that Dr. Slaughter and Christelle, are you going to present alone or do you have a team?
And he can just sit here. I've threatened to leave, and he can take the mic, but I don't think I'll do that. If you pass them out, thank you.
The benefit of those in the audience and watching, months ago, Dr. Slaughter was asked to perform a compensation study for the parish. She is following up that compensation study with an efficiencies and organizational study that will be presented in fairly soon, mm-hmm. I think next month. Mm-hmm. And so this is the first of her two reports. And so I would ask that you give attention to her.
Thank you.
And we will, at the end of her remarks, we will certainly have some questions, but we will also, I'll give the parish president a moment at the end of her remarks. Mr. President, I understand that you wanted to comment at the end of Christelle's remarks. He's not here. That's okay. So at the end of Christelle's remarks, I'll recognize the president, and after that, we will go to work from the council.
Great.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you, members of the council. We appreciate your support in this study. I do have two of our team members here tonight, Cody Saucier, who may join me at the mic for any technical questions, and one of our partners, Anita Byrne, who is in the back. We have been at this for a while, and I will tell you that compensation studies have become very popular in both the private and public sector, and especially along the Gulf Coast in the United States because of all the industrial activity and growth and expansion and what it's done with certain job classifications. So we see both the what they call the big crew change of the baby boomers who are now beginning to retire and leave with lots of experience, and organizations, public and private, that now have to attract new, younger, in some cases, talent. And there's not necessarily a match there. People with the appropriate skill sets generally are entering the market expecting more in terms of compensation, and so one of the interesting things that we were curious about is where does Ascension Parish stand in terms of your ability to keep up with the market, and especially since you are in the land of a lot of industrial plants and very competitive people in Baton Rouge. You know, what actually are your prospects for the future, and how hard is it going to be for you to catch up? So let me just go over a few of the basics. You issued a request for proposals in 2016 for an evaluation of the compensation plan for Ascension Parish Government approximating 400 employees, full-time employees. And as stated in the RFP, we were asked to, or bidders were asked to develop a compensation program to meet a set of specific criteria. Those were collecting background data, designing and administrating a job analysis questionnaire, conducting a custom salary survey, and performing job benchmarking and analysis. So we are almost a local organization. We're right down the road, and we have done this for a number of different organizations that are in the regional area that are public, as well as a number of private organizations. So we had a pretty good database for comparison to start with. When we outlined our methodology, we wanted to look at your current pay structure and your current benefit structure. We wanted to see the consistency between labor grades as well as steps, if there were any. We wanted to administer the job analysis questionnaire to every employee as we were asked to do, and update job descriptions as needed. We wanted to look at the current compensation and benefit package for each job classification, including retirement, benefit costs, health benefits, et cetera, and then assess each job classification in relationship to comparable classifications within private and public sectors to look at the minimum compensation package with benefits that would be market competitive. So with that, I'm going to start with page four. For those of you who like to follow along, I know there's a lot of data, and some of the members of the council are probably looking for some specific things, but I'm just going to walk through some of the highlights so that I can give you the opportunity to ask questions. So the first part of the methodology, as we said, was to evaluate the current salary and benefit structure. We had a very extensive data request, which kept your staff pretty busy for a while. We needed to look at every job description that was in existence, current pay plan and benefit information, organization charts, table of organization, manuals and documents that describe pay policies, and contact information for the key leaders and other staff who could fill in the gaps and provide information. We looked at the benefits and conducted a comprehensive benefit review, and that was everything from how you provided leave time to your employees, annual and sick, holidays, health insurance, and retirement, and those were compared to other regional public organizations, and I'll come back to that point in a minute. And then we took every job description that was in existence in Ascension Parish and compared that to a job analysis questionnaire. I think it's important that you know that every employee filled one out, and then their supervisor reviewed it and signed off on it, and we went back a second time and then had department directors sign off on it because we wanted to make sure that it was as current and accurate as possible. From there, we matched those to the database with regional market-based ranges and midpoints, and then brought that back to essentially a steering committee that was composed of department directors and key human resources people inside of the parish so that they could see if there are any discrepancies before we went further and drill down in our work. On page six, we have sort of some column names and descriptions so that everybody will understand what you're looking at when you look at the current columns with current market ranges, current Ascension Parish ranges, and then the market ranges. So recognize that what you look at in the tables that begin on page seven have to do with positions and not individuals. All right, so we're comparing a job description modified by a job analysis questionnaire, a position to another position in the regional market area. So that's important. Some of these positions are located in certain departments. There are some positions that are located, the same position in multiple departments. That was an important thing to look at as well. We included the labor grade that you assigned to this position, whether the position is exempt or non-exempt in your system. And then we give you the Ascension Parish minimum and maximum salary or wage translated to an hourly rate, and this was at the client's request. So everything is consistent. You're looking at everything hourly, compare one to another. And the final columns have to do with the market-based minimum and maximum salary range, again, translated into that hourly rate. You will see a number of positions are highlighted in yellow, and that indicates where a salary, Ascension Parish's minimum and maximum is lower than the market rate. In some cases, that is a very slight difference. In some cases, it's larger. But that is what the yellow highlighted positions mean. There are asterisks on some of the position titles. That indicates a position or groups of positions that we think merit looking into by staff or in a future study for potential consolidation. And I'll come back to why we feel that's an opportunity in a minute. And then in the department listing, if the initials NA are in that column, it indicates a position that does not have an incumbent. It has no one in that position right now. It may not even be assigned to a particular department. And let me explain to you what that means. The way your system works, the staff comes forward to you if they want a title approved for a new position. There are some titles that have been approved. Maybe no one was ever in the position. Maybe someone left the position. But the position is still there. It's created. There's a job description for it. There just happens not to be anyone in that position at the moment. So when you begin on page 7, in alphabetical order, you have the title of the position. As we said, the department, labor grade, exempt, non-exempt. And then your current Ascension Parish minimum and maximum salary range for that position, and then our recommendation for the current market position. Those proceed all the way through page 15, and let me give you some observations that we have about your salary ranges and your table of compensation. You have 180 positions, and you have 472 incumbents. So I'm going to say that again. You have 180 positions, and you have 472 incumbents. You got a lot of positions. So all those asterisks, as positions are created, there may be similar positions. There may be a position that was in another department that a department director didn't know. Some of these are left over from years and years ago. So you do have quite a number of position titles, if you will, making it a little bit more complex to manage your system. You are not as technologically prepared as you could be for these types of things. We, I think, behind the scenes probably created some frustration by some of our requests for data because we were asking people to match disparate data from different systems. So when you begin to see that in an organization like Ascension Parish Government, you realize that staff would have to work really hard to do this type of study, for example, but even to update a compensation plan in the way that it ought to be, making sure there's internal equity and external competitiveness. So our findings are as follows on salaries. 54% of your salary ranges, minimum and maximum, fall below the market-based range. So that's 97 positions out of 180 positions are below. This does not necessarily mean that an individual is below. It simply means the range is below. Many organizations have a policy of hiring at the minimum. You do not. But if you ever decided to go with something like that or just barely inside of the range, when your range is not market competitive, you will not be able to attract the talent that you need in those positions. There are 38 incumbents out of 472 that are paid below the market minimum. So the first number I gave you were positions. Now I'm talking about people. So you have 38 people who are not in the range. You have 116 people out of that 472 that are above your maximum. So they're out of your current range, 116 out of 472. You have allowed people to go above the range because of a number of different reasons as we talk to people about how this occurs. In some years, there have been adjustments, a cost of living adjustment. Sometimes there's a cost of living adjustment and a merit adjustment, and that is applied across the board to all employees. And so if I'm very close to the top of my range, it could take me past my range when I get that raise. We do not have any strict guidelines about placing new employees in a range at midpoint or below, or within X percent of midpoint, or only above a certain minimum, or 15% above the minimum with certain specialized skills or requirements. There's a wide band of where people can be placed. So if I'm placed high on my range when I come in, it's only going to be a few years before I top out and go beyond that. Annual raises have ranged from 2% to 9% over the past several years. Merit raises as such are not tied to a performance evaluation system. And these across-the-board raises tend to benefit your higher-salaried employees more than those at a lower salary range. So obviously it's relative to their pay. Although your Blue Book, your Ascension Parish Personnel Policy Manual, requires a compensation review every 3 years, this is the first one that you've done since 2009. And we do strongly suggest that you periodically review it, given what's going on in the market and turnover and potential turnover of employees. The final observation is that many of your current positions, your job titles, have only one or two people in that job title, and that's what I was referencing a few moments ago. So you have quite a proliferation of job titles and descriptions, and this adds to a difficulty in administering any type of normalized compensation plan adjustment, but it also makes it hard for one of your employees to find a career path, because I may be able to move to a different department, but I'm not really sure where that job is or what it's called, or if I'm in a similar job over here, does that really connect to that job over there? So if we clean that up, or if you all clean that up, it would be easier. Our recommendations then for salary are as follows. We recommend that you adopt the current market-based minimums and maximums for all of the positions. Those are the last two columns in those pages. We think you should establish these salary ranges, minimums and maximums for all positions, and this will address the 97 identified positions that are below the market-based range. So that'll take care of those positions, moving that salary range forward. So 100% of your salary ranges will be within the market at that point. The second recommendation is to bring your incumbents, bring your employees into the market. So all the incumbents who fall below that market minimum should be brought into the market range, and there are 38 of those, if you remember I mentioned that, who are below the market-based minimum. And we were asked to do a grid, I think in anticipation of an extremely large cost of moving people into the current market, and I will tell you, to move 100% at 100%, it is a whopping $55,244.80, which is amazing. When we worked with St. Tammany, some of you saw that study as we were competing in the RFP process. I think theirs was about over 100,000. They were pretty much in line as well. East Baton Rouge Parish, when we did theirs, they were millions of dollars out of whack. Nothing that could be accomplished in a year. So this is really pretty amazing. And that's an annual, that would be this cost to get them in, and then that would be an annualized cost going forward. Recommendation number three, establish and adhere to policies governing salary ranges and progression. You should address salary inflation by examining how an employee is compensated after he or she has reached the end of their position's salary range. So again, today there are 116 incumbents whose salary falls above the Ascension Parish maximum for their position. And when you allow those across-the-board raises or any raises beyond the top, what you do is really create a problem both for the parish and for the individual. So for the parish, now you're paying somebody higher than really what the market demands for that supply and demand for that position. You also make it harder for that person to transfer someone somewhere else or really stay in their market range. They can get far beyond it. If you adopted the new market ranges, instead of 116 people who are out of range, who are topped out, you'd only have 65. So 65 people would still be above the recommended market-based maximum, and we believe that their salaries should be frozen until they fall within the market-based range. The market will catch up. Some people will catch up sooner than others. I will just tell you, editorially, we do not believe that it is a good compensation philosophy to cut an employee's pay. It really isn't their fault that their salary went further than it should have, and if you just simply freeze it at this point, they will catch up, and at that point, it can move forward. We find that the parish is fond of cost of living awards, and these COLA awards, when they are given, should be tied to widely accepted indices such as the National Consumer Price Index. We think they should be utilized sparingly. You may have read in the paper recently that Mr. Decato, the civil service director for the state, is recommending a 2% cost of living adjustment for state civil service classified employees. That will be a 2% move of his entire salary structure. That is a good thing to do when your entire salary structure is way behind the market or behind the market. It is not going to address market inequities for a position such as a HVAC technician or electrician or engineer. You're still going to have those inequities, and now you've added 2% to your payroll budget. So when you're behind, that's good, and quite honestly, we think that's probably what kept you in the game. All right, so that's why what you have to spend now is less, because those were given periodically. But we find that a lot of private industry clients are getting away from cost of living adjustments. They're only doing it in very unusual years where they really wouldn't have any sort of performance-based merit pay, and it's usually, I think, 1.5% were the last ones that we saw. We do think that merit raises are excellent. We do think they should be tied to performance evaluations that are part of a development plan for employees. You have people who have been here many, many years, and they should have the opportunity to receive training and development coaching and then be rewarded for that. And we think that there's a lot of support for that from your directors and management team. Recommendation 4. In compliance with your own personnel policy manual, we do think it's a good idea to conduct a market-based compensation review, a comprehensive one every 3 years, to make sure that you have internal equity and external competitiveness. If, however, in off years, you are experiencing a lot of turnover in a position, your human resources department certainly can do a market study of that position. But if you're doing this every 3 years, you usually will stay in line, and you will not have significant expenses as you go to move the whole pay plan forward. Recommendation 5 is to consolidate similar job positions under one job title and create lines of progressions. You have secretaries, you have clerks, you have secretaries, different kinds of secretaries, you have secretaries in different departments, you have operators, you have these kinds of operators. That can all be rationalized, and we think, again, that this will help with promotional opportunities and progressions for some of your folks. Let me move through benefits fairly quickly. We looked at your entire benefit package, annual leave, sick leave, health insurance, retirement, and other notable benefits. On page 21, we have a table that outlines your current annual leave system. which allows for the accumulation of annual leave days. And you can see that under years of service, I can accrue 10 days as your employee up to 4 years, and then it's essentially 5 days increment for every 5 years, roughly, until I get to 30 or more years where I can earn 30 paid days of annual leave. On page 22, there's a table for those of you maybe from private industry who have not seen that kind of annual leave. You're not very different from your peers, however, because this is how public organizations over the years have managed to attract and retain their talent. Right. So you're right in line, actually. A little bit heavy on the 30 years, but you can see we put St. John the Baptist right next to you. They go up to 30 years. Some have trimmed it a little bit, but there are still neighboring parishes with very generous accumulations of annual leave. What you are doing, as we note on page 23, is you are rewarding people more at the end of their career, and you're doing that more than any other parish. And so with the thought of attracting new employees, this may be some sort of adjustment slide that you want to make or consider. This is actually starting at 11 years of service. Another parish does it at 25 years, but it's very generous at that 11-year mark. Comp time, you follow the policy, federal policy, that you can't use any accumulated sick or vacation leave except for those first 7 days after an accident. And your sick leave accrual is 3.7 hours per day or 12 paid sick days per year. Unused leave does roll over at the end of each year to the following year. You begin to accrue sick leave as soon as you're hired, but you can't use it until you pass the 90-day orientation period. And only full-time employees are eligible to receive this. You're seasonal or part-time or not. Employees are allowed to use up to 480 hours of sick leave toward retirement, and this is carried as a liability on your books. So on page 24, we give you a table that shows you your sister parishes and their sick leave policies, and you will notice that they are rather consistent. When we did the work for St. Tammany, they went back and trimmed some of their benefits, shifted some things, again, to try and make sure that they remained an attractive employer for newer employees, but you can see that it's still fairly comparable. On page 25, you do allow bereavement leave, and that's consistent. You have 13 paid holidays per year, and we give you some differences, and even people who have the same number may choose different holidays. On page 26, we begin to talk about your health insurance. And we found your health insurance to be very, very interesting because your health insurance premium that you pay for employees is very generous. You're paying 75% of the monthly premiums for your full-time employees and employees who work at least 30 hours a week. They're eligible for enrollment in the plan. And you also provide $1,500 annually to help cover the health savings account of the employees, which they can apply towards their deductible. What I want to tell you, however, is this is the most progressive plan that we have seen in all the parishes that we have studied, which is not, it's not hundreds. So let me caution you about saying that. But we were pleasantly surprised to see this because we are finding that public organizations who have not kept pace with changes in healthcare, when they get ready to make those changes, they're very severe. People will line up in the council chambers, very unhappy, and they feel like something is being taken away from them. I have pretty much grilled your staff to find out how did you do this? This is marvelous. So we find this to be a very progressive plan and something that will incent wellness and people taking some responsibility for their health care. And we do think that the fact that you are paying 75% of your employees' portion, although on page 27 you'll see it's pretty comparable. It's a great benefit, and we don't have suggestions to improve it. Your prescription drug benefit is comparable to other peers, and that brings us to retirement. And on page 29, we have spent more space and time than you would probably expect on retirement, but we think it's really important for you and the public to know some facts about your retirement system. You participate in the parochial employees retirement system, which we call PERS, of Louisiana Plan B, and mandatory enrollment is required of all employees who work 27 hours or more per week. It begins when someone is hired and requires 7 years of enrollment to be vested. Now, there's other detail in here. There's two plans, similar requirements, et cetera, et cetera. And in the rates that will be charged in 2017 has just come out, and the employer will be charged 12.5% their contribution for each employee in Plan A, and 8% for Plan B. And we're watching different retirement systems, and you know, everyone's trying to make sure they have solvent retirement systems, so those numbers are not out of line at all. The amazing part, and I have to tell you that I really would like to bold and highlight this next sentence. We did put it by itself so it would attract attention. Ascension Parish has funded Plan B at 98.46%, which means you're virtually fully funded. You are the envy of anybody who has a retirement plan like this anywhere, public or private. That is amazing. You've watched municipalities like Detroit and other places that can't keep up with funding their pension plans literally takes them under. So that's amazing. Congratulations. Don't let it slip. You can get away from you easily. And you also are in the Social Security system.
I wanted to make sure that you made that second statement.
Isn't that amazing?
Unlike other public systems here in Ascension Parish.
Exactly. So that's a marvelous benefit for your employees, and of course is one of the reasons why a lot of other public organizations can't suggest that people go on to Medicare and use their Medicare benefits instead of something else. So the fiscal underpinnings of what you're doing is made with very sound advice. You've had good consultants, I understand. Your staff has taken their recommendations, and the results are really, thank you for mentioning that. We do see some unique things that other parishes are doing with retirement to try and make them more portable for newer employees that are coming in. Again, we wouldn't suggest you doing anything that would upset the apple cart, so to speak. On page 30, we do note that you have $3.6 billion, the Ascension Parish government does, in Plan A and B assets. And you are the third largest retirement system in Louisiana. So, obviously your retirement benefits are comparable and they are well funded. You also have some notable employee benefits. Everyone can participate in dental insurance, basic life insurance, and vision insurance. And Ascension Parish not only pays 75% of those premiums for the employee, but they will do it for their eligible dependents, which is a very nice perk. On page 31, we have a few philosophical considerations to share with you. Because of the growing competition for people with talent and skills in the Gulf Coast region, because everyone's trying to hire that talent and retain them, we do think that you need to encourage staff to look forward on any adjustments that need to be made or processes that will keep you in line. We've recommended some already. Recommendation six is to continue to look for some market-based features that you can modify your current compensation model so that it will remain attractive. I don't know that a 401k or some sort of portable plan like Lafourche Parish is appropriate. I do think you have good advisors and you can follow their advice on that. That is a field unto itself. But we are seeing rewards and recognition programs becoming much more popular to attract younger workers, and that can be monetary or non-monetary. We're seeing pay-for-performance systems, and we're even seeing team-based rewards. We've seen some pilots at the state level, which are very interesting. So we encourage you to ask your staff to look into those things. And finally, recommendation 7 is to ensure that you have processes to monitor and the causes of turnover. You do not have high turnover right now, although you have it in some areas that's a little higher than others. But we recommend that you monitor that, possibly even coming back to the council once a year, talking about turnover and any positions that are hard to fill. We recommend that you conduct exit interviews and try and find out, are any of these compensation and benefit related, or are they some sort of organizational or operational problem? And sometimes compensation problems are real. Sometimes they're perceived. Inequities are always on people's mind. But we do think that your staff needs to monitor that, and that will help you detect things before they get out of hand. So with that, we try to keep this as compact as possible. I'm happy to answer questions, and I'm sure there are some.
Absolutely. I do think that, Mr. President, I think you had a comment that you wanted to make.
Yes, I just want to say that, you know, as I said before, I've got with my staff, we're going to implement all of these recommendations that Dr. Slaughter has recommended. And we started working on some of them already, but I told y'all from the beginning that whatever was recommended, we will comply.
We appreciate that, sir. That's amazing. We'll see.
And one job that jumps out in front of me is the CDL license. Bill called me the other day, we got to go up a couple dollars an hour because we can't get them. I also talked to Dr. Doty about, in the past, we told him, go get your license, but now I think we might have to front them the money to go through the license if they pass. If they don't pass, then we don't pay it. But we're looking at that one instance.
Interesting. So I think, is it appropriate to have public comment at this point? I got kind of off my protocol here, and I do have a speaker who wants to speak to this matter. Jeff? And then the council can begin. That gives you all a little time to look, and then we'll start on our questions. Thank you, sir.
Good evening. I appreciate what Dr. Slaughter and SSA presented. I think it's much needed in this parish. I think we all could use an outside look at our operation. We're talking about public dollars here. And in that line, and I know that this is a multi-part study, so tonight we just had this overview. I would ask this council, this committee, to put the package that y'all have on the parish website so that every citizen could look at it. I would ask that.
I don't think that's an unreasonable request. We certainly will do what we can to accommodate that.
Thank you. And then my next questions, I guess, would be, I hope would be, well, I don't know where to direct them, either to SSA or to the administration, or both, and this committee, the finance committee, is I don't understand why we have three general managers. We have a CAO. We have a chief of staff. Okay, one general manager I can understand. Lamar Dixon is deserving of that, and but I don't know and don't see what the other two do. I don't see what the chief of staff does. And I'm looking at those dollar amounts that we pay out monthly to those positions. And why? Where does it go? What is being done? Has it been clearly delineated for all of us? Where are those dollars going? I don't see it. The other thing I don't understand is how can the head of mosquito control make more than the head of OEP? How? Especially considering what we went through last year in March and again in August. How? I do not understand that. The other thing is, with all these dollars we're throwing around out there, at the upper end of the parish, I'm not talking about the rank and file workers. I'm not talking about my neighbors and friends. I'm talking about up here. What is that going to cost us? My child, my grandchildren. What is it going to cost us in retirement benefits in the future? Because that paycheck is going to be cashed at some point. And I question that.
In response, I would like to mention that we have a, Christelle will be bringing back to us in May a report on our efficiencies and operations, and I believe at that time that all of the questions that that the member of the community asked are likely to be answered. So we look forward to that.
If I might address a couple of things, and thank you, Councilwoman Casso, because structural questions really relate more to that next report. But I do think that it's a very good observation or question about mosquito control and OEP. And there is a pretty strict science and education requirement for mosquito and rodent abatement. I will tell you, we've been contacted by a number of those departments across the state. The Secretary of Health and Hospitals is talking quite a bit about the Zika virus. And it reminds me a little bit of Y2K, when everybody with a computer, any kind of computer training became very much in demand. So that is very interesting. It does get into the market value of somebody's job. And so, you know, there are some positions that you would say, well, gee, this ought to be more important than that. But there are anomalies there. I very much appreciate the question. And the job description can show some of those qualification differences and training.
All right. So we will begin with questions. I'll start on my right. Councilman Joseph.
Not right now.
Councilman Dawson.
Thank you, Christelle. Very thorough job. I had a, you know, maybe it's in here, and I didn't get it. It's the first time that we're looking at this also. Mm-hmm. But in the job position category, you had, I think it was 180 positions that you found. Mm-hmm. If there were a consolidation, what's the recommendation that number be reduced to?
It's much more challenging to consolidate jobs than it looks on the surface. So I would not really want to take a guess there. But if you just eyeball it and look at, we do not suggest, for example, if you have gradations of a job, Secretary 1234 or Operator 1234, those are progression opportunities. So you wouldn't necessarily consolidate those. But you might look for all the ones that have very similar minimum qualifications, job requirements, et cetera. We're working in St. Tammany doing that right now. You have utility operators. You have operators in DPW. They are creating an operator sort of category and then sort of a rider or an addendum on the job description. So is that, you know, one, or is that, you know, it's one job title for operator. However, you got to match it to the right department and requirements, you have certification requirements that are different, et cetera. So I'm not answering your question. Have you noticed?
Let me try to skin the cat another way.
Okay.
So
I'm sorry.
If you you had an organization about this size comparable or government organization, how many would you expect
there you
to
go.
See?
Okay. When we Yeah, you know, I think 150 is reasonable. So
150, okay.
You know, as opposed to 180. The state of Louisiana actually went to a clustering of jobs. They're under a strict civil service system, so it's a little bit different. But in order to help them manage an amazingly complex system, we don't think you need to do that. If you had a lot of rules and a merit system and steps and things like that, it would tighten up your system. But we think you're doing just fine. You just need strong policies and to adhere to them. And if you had about 150 positions for roughly 500 people, it's reasonable.
Okay. I see the carryover of the sick time, and I carry that over up to 480 hours and when it gets time to retire. Is that correct?
Yes.
And then there's a carryover from year to year if they need it. Is that correct?
Yes.
Is there short-term disability? I didn't see that in here.
I don't believe there is short-term disability that's included in with the long-term.
So there is short-term disability? Well, just say, maybe we could look at short-term disability versus carrying over a lot of sick time.
Mm-hmm. Where it gets expensive is if someone, as their retirement benefit is computed usually off of last few years, then I got that sick time. It's accrued 480, and then I'm able to.
That increases their benefit.
Right. Yeah. So. Every system is different. In Baton Rouge, when we were doing their study, we watched someone get $100,000 cash check for leave.
For leave.
So that's where it gets expensive.
Right. Well, I mean, I see 12 weeks, which, mm-hmm. It's not a year like you sometimes see.
Right.
However, I just wonder if maybe there's a better solution for our employees in the short-term disability rather than...
That would be the substitute.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Again, I think that's an earned benefit, and so if and when you would ever decide to tweak that or change it, I think that people who've been in the system...
Yeah, my grandfather, some people,
yeah.
Or something,
yeah.
I agree with that. And I... probably should know the answer to this, but because I'm not in the retirement system, is it guaranteed benefit or is it guaranteed contribution?
It's a defined benefit plan.
A defined benefit.
Mm-hmm.
Okay,
yes,
and it's 98. That's why the 98.46. Yeah.
It's amazing.
Yeah, that is.
Nobody has that. That's why everybody went to defined contribution, right? Because we couldn't keep up the other
way.
So
I would assume that people that participate in the Social Security, and I don't know what that is, Plan A or Plan B, whichever one, that their defined benefit is reduced by that amount.
You're going to have to ask someone who's a lot closer. Every word that's in here has been sanitized and corrected and edited so that we did not publish incorrect information. So I'm going to ask Ms. LeBlanc.
I sit on the board of the parochial retirement system, and... repeat your question again.
So we have Plan A and Plan B, and I don't know which one of them has Social Security and one doesn't.
Right. The intent of Plan B with Social Security was that it would equal out, but over the years it really doesn't equal out to 100%, but that was the intent of it.
Mm-hmm. So the question was if somebody gets a defined benefit, so they get whatever their percent of their salary.
Right.
Is the one that participate in Social Security, is their benefit reduced by the amount of Social Security?
No, there's no offset for Plan B participants for Social Security. They get 100% of what they would be entitled to.
Okay. But the company and the employee both contribute less.
Right. Plan B is 2%. And Plan A is 3% without Social Security.
So what I did notice there is that it doesn't add up to what Social Security costs. It's like 6.2%. Employer-employee each contributes 6.2. That's not the difference. I don't know how that found that odd. But that's all the questions I had, but thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Turner.
Yes, I suppose the... the raises for the employees, especially the lower level employees. You said you prefer to do as merit based instead of cost of living. Now, somebody is, I guess, cutting the grass. How are we going to merit base their raises?
There are a number of different systems that we see out there. Some of it are satisfactory, unsatisfactory. You get a satisfactory, you get your merit. Some are 1, 2, 3, some are scales of 5, some have very elaborate matrices that, you know, end up with, you know, somebody trying to figure out, did this come out like I wanted it to come out? So we see in public organizations standard merit raises across the board in most cases. So if a 3% merit raise or a 5% merit raise is granted, then pretty much everybody gets it unless you were really rated unsatisfactory, and then there's usually a required review within 60 or 90 days, and then maybe a performance improvement plan leading to either solving the problem or discipline up to termination. We hear a lot of public organizations talk about differentiated merit, and that is in the state proposal, as I understand it, that there would be between 2% and 7%. We had a state agency in our office this afternoon right before we came here, and we had, if I say who it was, you'll know which agency it was. We had one of the top people who said, that's going nowhere. So I think that the theory behind it is very good. I think that this is not meant to punish someone from receiving a merit raise. It's more about trying to get good communication between a supervisor and employee and feedback about how well they're doing so that there's no surprises if someone is disciplined or terminated because we've given them this feedback and given them a chance to improve. So again, in public organizations, what is defined as merit, once a merit raise is adopted by an entity, it almost always is distributed across the board. That's just a reality.
So basically, if an individual, say he's been here 2 or 3 years and hasn't gotten a pay raise, at that point, and we've moved to the merit-based system, they should more than likely be terminated at that point?
I think there's two different things going on in your question. So the merit usually becomes the pay raise. So I receive the 2%, 3%, 5%, up to whatever that's granted because I'm doing a satisfactory or above average job. So as long as I'm doing that, that becomes my raise.
So in theory, if you don't get your raise, you're not doing satisfactory, so you should be terminated.
That's going way, you know, counselor, I feel like you're kind of pushing me into there. If you don't get your merit, you don't get your merit. It does not necessarily mean that your entire job performance would be unsatisfactory, but we almost never see that done. So if you're going to withhold merit, you pretty much are saying the person is unsatisfactory, and usually that kicks in some other performance improvement plan or some other system. It's forced upon the supervisor. So what we see in public organizations, private too, is if you make it hard to rate somebody outstanding, and I have to put a lot of paperwork on that, I'm not doing it. So you're a 4. Maybe nobody's a 5 because that's too much work. If I'm going to rate you a 0 or a 1 or unsatisfactory and I got to go through all this other baloney, forget it. I'll just rate you. That's just it. The system drives people's behavior. What we think is it's fine to give merit raises. It makes more sense than cost of living adjustments, but at the end of the day, they are really across the board in almost all cases. But if you really want to get an employee's attention to drive them to some performance improvement, you can do it by withholding their merit. You don't necessarily terminate, though. It usually forces some sort of better conversation.
Now, for the criteria itself, you know, who would usually develop that criteria? Would that be the Parish Government, the Human Resources Department?
Yes, exactly. Parish Government, Human Resources Department, working directly with department directors and people who understand the difference between a grass cutter and another kind of job so that we're not using arbitrary goals and objectives and trying to make one size fits all.
So the criteria need to be individually tailored for each department or each job description?
Absolutely. Yes.
Maybe two more questions.
Absolutely.
Now, as far as the career path and organizational chart, so as far as right now, we don't have one, is what you're saying?
I did not say that.
Okay, I'm sorry.
It is. You don't have well-established career paths. You do have organization charts because they're published in your budget. So theoretically, I, as your employee, could look through your organization chart and begin to see how I might be able to progress. In our next study, we will be coming to you with a revised recommendation for an organization chart. And so we think that it could provide some clarity to that going forward.
So if I'm cutting grass, what's my next level up?
Oh, that's where you get into what the parish president was just talking about CDL licenses and things like that. So, for example, in some parishes, you start out, you're literally entry level, whether we call them a laborer or whatever we call it, and then we do some internal training or we allow people to go and get training. If we don't give them some sort of bump in pay when they get something like a CDL, they're gone. They're picked off. They got better opportunities. So we really, to that point, you will see recommendations about developing. We had a big discussion about it the other day when we were trying to, you know, have one more look at all this data. We really would like you to have some strongly defined career paths in those low-level, entry-level employees, because once you've invested in them, you would hate to lose them. And it's not just compensation-based. It could be, payment for, taking the exam and passing it. It could be a career progression from there. So you could start as a grass cutter. You could be trained. We have people now who are actually the equivalent of heavy equipment operators but may not receive the certification because you're training them internally. But we think that, you know, all of those things can sort of be linked together into a good career progression type of system. When somebody gets really good, I'm going to tell you, if you've trained them all the way up, they're gone. But we think you can keep them pretty long. We think you can accomplish that.
So basically, if I'm cutting grass and I get my CDL, at that point I should get a raise.
Yeah.
And
if you want to keep them, and they're valuable, right?
I guess my question is, if there's no position available next once I got my CDL, and I'm still in the same position, but I do have a CDL at this point, should they still get that raise, or should it be once a position comes available?
No, when you get that CDL, we strongly recommend you get that raise.
Okay,
it's related to the superior knowledge or experience that you're demonstrating for that job right now, and so you have more flexibility where you assign that person. We had a big discussion about off-road and on-road and a lot of things that I don't even totally understand, but that is a more valuable employee to you. So even though there may not be the next level of position available, now I have somebody that I can use in different circumstances because they've achieved that.
Right, this may be an extreme example. So say Mr. Lawler, Attorney Lawler, decides he wants to cut grass for the parish. Should he get compensated more than their regular grass cutter?
Because he's a lawyer? No, sir. So. And I know you are too, but I'm sorry. No. It's irrelevant.
So only if the degree or whatever they get, the license they get is relevant to
that. Yeah, but if he wants to go get some certification, or be a water operator with some lab testing or something, we might consider that. That would be worth it. Does that help?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
That was my last question.
Thank you.
Mr. Satterley.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. And thank you, Christel.
Thank you.
Is it Christel or Crystal?
Christel.
Christel.
Anything close is
okay.
Good.
I'm going to try.
Okay.
You said that you were tasked to look at positions and not individuals, and I think that was wise. In so doing, your second comment this evening was that you went obviously and looked at job descriptions in existence. I think that was wise. I'm going to hang in a minute on the word in existence in this regard. Later on, you said that we had 180, if I got it right, positions in the parish with 420 incumbents. Meaning we have, that's employees.
Yes, 472.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And you, I'm going to quote you here, said we, as a result, have a lot of employees. And I think in answering Mr. Dawson's questions a minute ago, we've said that maybe a reasonable size for our organization might be around 150.
Positions, not employees.
Okay, so now we're back to positions.
Yes, and if I misspoke, I apologize.
Okay, okay.
You have a lot of job titles.
But I'm working toward this.
Mm-hmm.
You said that 54%, I think, of the positions are below market value range. In fact, I captured 97 positions maybe being below of the 180. That would
yes.
be, I haven't done the math, it sounds like 54%.
Yes.
Of those, back to job descriptions, you said you looked at an existence.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know how to ask this other than, shouldn't every one of the positions have a job description? Or how bad is that? Is that a problem? And how many do we not have?
We haven't done one of these yet where we could find every job description. There's always one or two or whatever. But what we did find was we had a number of job descriptions that were out of date for whatever reason, because when the job analysis questionnaire was completed and the supervisor and department director signed off on it, we saw enough difference that we felt we needed to amend the job description that was part of our contract. It was about 110.
So our employees are not signing something saying that we understand this is our job description?
That's a good question for next time.
Okay.
I don't think so.
Okay. Number two, Ascension Parish, you said health insurance, I'm going to have the exact quote again, the premium payment that we make, which I think is 75%, you called it, quote unquote, very generous. And I assume that means comparative to other parishes and so forth, municipalities you've done studies with your company. You also said 98% of the funding for retirement, you used the word, was amazing. So we're very generous and we're amazing on health insurance and retirement, respectively. You even went as far as to say we're the third largest retirement system in the state of Louisiana. And you're competing with some bigs there. I'm a member, for example, of TRSL, and it's huge. For those at home, that's Teachers Retirement System of Louisiana. You said 74% even of our 75% of our dental is paid for by for employees by a parish as well as dependents. So when you add all that up, in the beginning, my first blush was I saw all this yellow. And my concern was, wow, if the highlight means we have all these employees that are undervalued, do they recognize that they also are getting these wonderful perks from the standpoint of retirement, health insurance, dental insurance, the amazing stuff and the very generous stuff? What did you detect?
It's a wonderful question. That's exact. It's a look at the total compensation. Exactly. And so do employees realize it? We think that's why your turnover is low.
Well,
so they can go work.
I would use myself as an example.
Mm-hmm.
I was recruited heavily at lots of universities and mm-hmm. left because the retirement system in Louisiana, this TRSL I mentioned, was wonderful.
Right.
So you can afford to stay and make. They did something called the Southern Regional Educational Board Average, which is all the 1860s land-grant universities in the southeastern part of the United States. And you can make 20, 30, 40% below at LSU, but still come out okay.
Right.
Because you've got, you opted to get out of Social Security and you're into the retirement. Okay, so that makes me feel better. Second question under the yellow, though, is that I kind of look at it, and I've got this impression right now, but I only have this a little while, and I need to study it. Is it mostly, I'm trying to look for a politically correct word.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to take a shot. The grunts, the that's not a good word. The lower level employees that aren't making a whole lot of money seem to be more in that yellow category than the higher up paid employees. Would that be your impression, or am I reading that?
We have.
You haven't commented on that, and I don't want.
We have not commented on that. And we've had some interesting team discussions about that. Without doing any kind of statistical analysis, however, I will tell you that we oftentimes find the higher level positions, people at the top of the organization chart, to be the higher paid. But people watch those positions, and if they're trying to appoint people, they usually make sure those salaries are intact. Those were more away from the market than, generally speaking, your other positions.
So if we take your recommendation number 3 on page 19 and we, quote-unquote, freeze these salaries until they fall within market-based ranges for the particular position, Won't these people just leave? Won't they just bolt and
These
say,
are only the 65 or so incumbents. These are only, this is a small percentage of people that our guess is they've been here a long time.
How did they get so far to whack? I mean, this might be the same question that Councilman Turner asked, and I hate to be redundant, but HRM is recommending to the parish president or someone administration to give a raise, whether it's COLA or a merit or whatever, or is the parish president just saying this individual's getting this much? Because we read some stuff in the paper, quite frankly, that's not friendly to the parish from the standpoint that, you know, people getting two-digit high percentages, 20, 30, 40% raises, which is very hard for me to understand and to explain to my constituency.
The band is back from 2% to 9%. 9%, which I think was COLA and merit or whatever you want to call it,
up there in
was
tens and tens of percent.
Was brought to you by, was brought to this council, not you, was brought to the council by the parish president, the last parish president, I understand. And so it comes from the administration as a recommendation. It was voted on. I believe in this budget, you have 4%, 2% has been granted only. So there's still in the budget an opportunity for 2 more percent.
Did you detect any problems with morale for people that aren't getting, that are getting 2% when other people are getting 15, 20%? Or?
I can't say that we, in this part of the study, talk to enough frontline employees to be able to give you a full picture. We were talking more with the supervisors and department directors and the people who were looking at those job analysis questionnaires. Really didn't inquire about satisfaction. But again, I think your question is good. I think that people can be satisfied with their pay and their benefits and unsatisfied with working conditions or some other parts of the job. I have old equipment, it's hard for me to do my job, et cetera, et cetera. So I think there are a lot of causes to poor morale. I don't suspect that it's this. Even in the labor positions or in DPW, as we were talking about the other day, you're guaranteeing your employees 40 hours a week. So I might have good skills and I could go to the plant, but I may not have as good retirement benefits, consistent health benefits, and I may not get the schedule. So you become attractive to those positions in that way.
Exit interviews. Do we have a policy, and is everyone getting an exit interview? And if so, who's conducting them? I mean, what do we do with that
data? Spotty,
right?
It's spotty. You'll hear in our next report, we did an audit of personnel files.
So we don't. If someone leaves us, we don't necessarily know the reason.
Correct. Correct.
Christelle.
Thank you.
Got it.
Good.
If you were king and you had one thing to change, queen, in terms of Ascension Parish and what we're not doing, maybe the best we can, based on all of you found out now, what would be the one recommendation you would make to this committee that we need to do right now?
I think from a total compensation perspective, I'm not sure the magic that has worked with your current workforce is going to work with your next workforce. So, you're getting ready to have a significant number of current employees who are already eligible for retirement. We're going to bring you those workforce statistics. And so when I look at that and I realize how many positions are going to need to be refilled, what it's going to take to attract them, the salary study shows that you're not really that far off in general, but these are not really lucrative salaries. There are places where, with certain skills, I can go and earn more money in my pocket, in my hand, in my bank account today. But if I'm willing to hang around here for a long time, I'm going to have really good retirement, just like you just said with TRSL.
What's the perks?
I'm going to have really good leave that I can cash in. Possibly I'm going to have 13 holidays a year. If that's important to me, this is really attractive. This is just one of the best we've seen. I just don't know that they're making that many people who are like that anymore. And so when we get rid of this crop, I think
in getting new people, we used to have a problem with graduate research assistantships for students that would come.
Right.
And at LSU, we would waive your out-of-state tuition and pay you a lower amount of a stipend, mm-hmm. versus if you went to Texas A&M or Alabama or somewhere else in the Southeast, they would pay the students a whole lot more. And the students right. couldn't see that they were paying, though, at that state, an out-of-state tuition.
Right.
And from a marketing standpoint, we had a lot of problems.
Right, right.
And so I'm just wondering, is it better just to pay them and let them deal with the other part, or are we doing the right? I mean, you haven't made a recommendation that we back off of any of these wonderful, amazing, generous things you're talking about that the parish does.
Unfortunately, and I think our last governor ran headlong into the wall on trying to do something dramatically different with the retirement system and go to a cash only, and actuarially it would have been a huge problem. There might be ways to incorporate a portable plan without throwing off your retirement system. You would need someone who is a subject matter expert in that area to study that. But beyond that, I think that figuring out programs like reward and recognition, figuring out either a variable merit, figuring out, how can I get, for somebody who's willing to come here and work hard, even if they only want to work here 3 years, 5 years, which is what the younger generation wants to do, and they may want to move on, they may not, they may stay 2 years, whatever. It needs to be worth their while to be able to do that. And we just don't quite have enough bells and whistles that are that attractive. The good news is not a lot of other people do, too. In our MBA class, we have engineers from ExxonMobil and BASF and all kinds of other places. They're struggling with the same thing. But you can get ahead of that. I mean, you can do that.
Thank you, ma'am.
Councilman Lambert.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The quick fix, is this the $55,284?
That's it.
What was the next parish? What was their call?
It would be St. Tammany, and they were about 160 or so thousand. theirs is online.
Well, I'll go on record here. That CDL license that we're talking about,
mm-hmm.
not only is it going to help out with good driving habits, they're going to also have, you have to stay healthy now. I have a chauffeur's license, and all the other things here will fall in line with what you're saying, that we are excellent.
Mm-hmm.
So I think we should bite down hard here and pay
mm-hmm.
for the employee. If they want to take the initiative to step up and take this test, we should pay for it.
I think that's an excellent recommendation, and I do think that's consistent with what President Matassa said a little while ago. Let me go back and link your comments together.
Right.
That's an example of something that a young person might find attractive. If you're going to send me out to training, not just send me to a conference, not something
right.
unspecified, but if you are going to send me to something where it's a certification or something that's job-related, and you're either going to pay for me to do that, or you're going to pay for me to study. We saw that in Jefferson Parish, where inspectors, they didn't have time to study. They were working overtime so much they couldn't study for the certification, so they really got compromised and were easy to pick off. But if you can figure out what we call skill-based pay and add that in, it doesn't necessarily change your market ranges, but it will give somebody a bump, and that's an employee who's gone out on their own, done some things, is more likely to be more productive. That's a great example.
Between CDL and welders, if you want to step up, and I mean, everyone's calling for those
right.
skill sets.
That's right.
The other question I had is, the yellow AP hour versus the market hour. I counted 122. Even though these positions, I see you have some that's NA, not a
mm-hmm. not filled, right?
Mm-hmm. We headed into sewer and wastewater and different things here, and I say they have supervisors and other. I think we need to leave these positions on here, because mm-hmm. Someone knew down the road we was going to end up having these positions.
Mm-hmm.
What are your thoughts?
We agree completely, Councilman Lambert, and that is why they are included. some of these are positions that a department director may anticipate needing in the future. Sometimes they're not filled because they have an incumbent in another position who has a certain skill set, but they think in the future they could get rid of that and upgrade it. So it in some cases is a good example of workforce planning. It may not be in all cases, but we definitely agree that they should be on there.
Thank you. Appreciate you.
So, Christelle, I have just a couple of questions.
Mm-hmm.
I've heard you say performance appraisals, merit raises, performance improvement plans, training. I'm going to do kind of like Doc. What's the one thing to accomplish those things that we...
You have a personnel manual that is in existence, and we are not finished reviewing it, but it's good. It's not followed. So if you follow even the basic processes that are outlined in your own manual, then you will begin to have some of these rudimentary things. However, as Councilman Turner was asking, you know, the devil's a little bit in the details. So what is the form going to look like for a grass cutter, and how am I going to make sure somebody understands how I'm going to evaluate that performance? It doesn't go that far, but it does outline a lot of processes that I think, for whatever reason, have fallen by the wayside or have not been consistently adopted and utilized. So we will be bringing you recommendations if we see things that are out of order and that we're not finished going through it. But you got the basics in there. So follow the guidelines you have.
I'm concerned as well about the leave policy, so I'm hoping we'll kind of talk about that some more as we go along, what might could be done to not have these huge checks at the end of the day.
Right. And back to the comment about future workforce, and if I had a magic wand, you're paying a lot there. If I could grandfather people into what we've already promised them, even though some parish presidents and councils didn't even do that, but even if I did that, but I could push some of that earlier to people. There are in the new workforce a lot of surveys that are being done now that say that time off is as important as a paycheck to younger employees. So if you stay here a long time, wow, you're going to have a lot of time off, but you're not going to stay here that long. So one parish, we actually, you know, worked with them to sort of push some days a little earlier in the pipeline, so that right where we thought people were leaving, it would sort of be the incentive. Well, if I stay, I'll get, you know, a few more days of paid leave next year or whatever. So you can tweak it or you can dramatically change it.
What kind of solvency, how do we determine the long-term solvency of that retirement system as we begin to truly begin to work into it?
This is where I believe you've had advisors working with your staff, as well as your chief finance officer is on the board, mm-hmm, of that retirement system. So I think you have access to very up-to-date and good information. And if you wanted to look into something else, you know, you would have resources available to do that. Again, I think that the position is enviable, and whereas that may not be important enough for a new employee to stay 7 years, okay, that's fine, but I'd rather try and manage that with some other way of incenting somebody to stay than do something that would risk the solvency of my retirement system.
Mr. President.
Christelle, years ago we had 10 years and we knocked it to 7 years. So, you know, we changed it back then.
And so that's going to be more attractive. Thank you. That's more attractive. I could vest earlier. I could vest and leave and still have that. Those are the kinds of things that I think are in that progressive mode of thinking, nibbling at that, and then others that you could do.
Wonderful. Thank you. Mr. Kluwat?
Yeah, Christelle, thank you very much. First of all, about the positions, the 180 positions, I believe we can do some tweaking on that. But that's not the biggest thing to me, because if you look at the all independent positions, I think one of the most important things to do is you got a group of 10 positions that are basically in the same pay scale. Yeah, different departments, different things, similar job descriptions,
right.
The same pay scale.
Mm-hmm.
So I think the pay scale, developing a pay scale, mm-hmm. is very important, and given a range. And if you start somebody at the top of the range, they might have an issue.
Yep.
If you're following your pay scale.
That's right.
All right?
That's right. Mm-hmm.
So, just looking at the merit raise, I don't have a problem with that. I mean, I know we have a certain amount of contract workers within the parish. People,
right.
Substitute contract workers, and we have part-time workers. So, given those folks, sometimes what we do in industry, we look at those and we try to go with those percentage raises.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
The old saying, what's written on the bathroom wall is a cost of living raise. Okay.
Right.
So we use the consumer price index.
Mm-hmm.
Is a benchmark to start talking raise, mm-hmm. on that subject. But every year as we build a budget, we may budget 5% raise.
Right.
But we got to see how the company's going to do.
Right.
What did the year give us?
Right.
In the plants, did we have a bunch of crash downs and plant not running? In the parish, did we have 2 hurricanes and a 6-foot flood? Okay,
right.
That type of stuff. So,
mm-hmm.
so why you budget? And budgeting is just your best outlook. While you budget, that don't necessarily mean that that's what's going to be given at the end of the day.
Right.
And that's what the people that manage got to understand.
Right.
Now, on the merit, I do believe in the merit system. Right. Because one thing that the merit does for you, it puts you in front of somebody that has your future in their hands.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Hopefully it's somebody that you respect, that you work for, that's going to be honest with you. 3 things it does. It lets you know the negatives, and that's usually what comes out first and stings the worst. It does for me anyway, right? Then you get a sip of water, and then you look at the positives. You try to reflect the positives. But also you develop at the end, when you walk away from it, we got a plan.
Right.
Right?
Right. That's
you got
right.
a plan.
Yeah. That's the key.
You're cutting grass.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, what do you want? What do you want to be?
Mm-hmm.
Like I tell the kids, what do you want to be when you grow up?
Right.
What do you want to be?
Right.
Well, I want to be the general manager.
Yep.
There you go. Well, here's your career path right here.
Right. Right.
And so you got to develop those, and you're going to catch that in the next round, because you're going to develop I'm going to say the position versus the qualification.
Right.
If mm-hmm. This parish is no different, and me sitting here as a council member, I'm no different than I am inside the gates of the industry. When we need somebody, when old Joe leaves and we need somebody, we're going to look around and we want to grab our best guy.
Right.
We may advertise, put it out on the web, whatever it
mm-hmm.
takes. But for tomorrow, we still got work that got to go on, so we're going to grab our best guy. We may grab a guy completely out of that division of work. But he's got good leadership skills. He's been around a long time. He understands management. He knows how to get a job done. So, boom, we go grab him, put him in there.
Right.
Sometimes those people get trapped outside of their expertise
mm-hmm.
and their educational backgrounds or their experience backgrounds. right? That's our fault as management.
That's right.
Sometimes we leave them in there.
That's right.
But we set people up for failure.
Mm-hmm.
So I do believe in the merit system, because if nothing else, it gets somebody in front of somebody every year. Because it's not unusual in the public world to have the employee of the year and fire them. They go from hero to zero.
Wow.
Right? You know?
Yeah.
So that what we like out of our workers who are not elected, they're professionals.
Right.
Develop them, let them work, treat them like professional workers. So we need to get that system in place.
Yeah.
We get job descriptions and a scale, mm-hmm, and a range. Mm-hmm. I looked at all the yellows like everybody else said. We're not, even though it's yellow, we're not that far off.
Not that far off. Right.
And I do want to expand on the benefit program. Gwen, I think we gotta guarantee this these billions of dollars, right? And you sit on, people sit on boards to manage that and guarantee that those billions are there when somebody goes to get it.
Right. That's Plan B's.
Yeah.
Statewide.
And, you know, we have a saying in industry that, you know, poor management works good under good economic times, you understand? But when we get tight, well, if we fall on the 5 years of bad oil industry, bad whatever's right, your normal tax base,
mm-hmm,
you fall under some bad years, then it starts getting crunchy.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, I just feel like if we bring people up, mm-hmm, bring them through the ranks, and hope that in the time coming that your reporting will recognize what we need, the normal qualifications, okay?
Right.
Because we may have a guy that's not a degreed employee that's got 20 years in, and there's nobody in the United States can do that job better than him.
That's
and
right.
I'd like to see him keep it, okay?
That's right.
But under normal qualifications, this is what's normal in this position.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, lean more toward the area, but lean to public work.
Right, right.
You know, it's not always comparable to private.
Right. If I might just add a couple of things, Councilman Kluwat, that I think you really are setting the stage for. The last comment you just made, you have picked up some people who have retired and have a lot of skills.
Right.
And we do think that if you make a job attractive enough, you can get talent that way in the future. We're seeing more of that, but you're going to have some flexibility and different sorts of things. But back to your comments about performance evaluation and Chairman Casso, your comments as well. One of the things that we have discussed with some of the department directors, when you are as generous as you are, for example, with sick leave, that's granted to that employee. An employee who is using a lot of sick leave will leave a void in a team. If you have people who are on Family Medical Leave Act leave, and you have people on sick leave and or vacation leave, all of a sudden, who's cutting the grass? So we've watched private industry, just to give you a wonderful example of how performance appraisal can really help a parish increase productivity by looking at sort of the average use of sick time and with a particular employee suggesting that they have a goal maybe in the next year, the next quarter, or whatever, of not using as much sick time, or counseling the employee about repeated sick days. I think you require a doctor's excuse after 2 days, but those are things that people can work on. Those are very real things, and that's money to the parish. That's more productivity. So you can do a lot with performance evaluation and merit pay, as all of you all have mentioned. It's a great suggestion.
And you know, one of the last things I want to talk about is the workforce. We got to study people.
Mm-hmm.
We have very educated baby boomers, very educated Gen X's, and very educated millennials, right? Three different mindsets. We are going to have a major turnover.
Mm-hmm.
Baby boomers, we're right on the edge of the baby boomers. all right? The Gen X, they don't necessarily want to hang around till they're 75.
That's right.
Okay?
That's right.
The millennials, they're looking for a different kind of benefit. Mm-hmm. They have a different look at the job profiles, you know? We're not competing with the European profile yet, but we're getting close to it.
Mm-hmm.
And Social Security, they've got a lot of the millennials. They don't worry about what's all the fuss about Social Security. They don't honestly believe
that's
that
right.
politically
it's
going to be there when they get
exactly
there.
That's exactly right.
Okay?
That's what they tell us. Right.
Right? Between the Gen X and mm-hmm. the
boomers. We're going to spend it all.
Yeah.
Yep.
I'm going to try to get my share.
We all are.
But anyway,
that's exactly
what I'm
right.
saying, so that mm-hmm. that's not the deal for them.
Right.
And people that don't have true pensions, the 401ks and the contributions mm-hmm. of guaranteed non-taxable monies,
mm-hmm.
it works for them.
Right.
But they're looking for the thing when they get on a job site. They need to know that they mean something on the job site,
mm-hmm.
okay? They have to have some personal gratification mm-hmm. for showing up and working that day.
Right.
Right? And I believe a good structure with the scales mm-hmm. and a path forward in any department or even across department lines based on qualifications, some type of structure, normal movement, you know, I got a couple guys I've been friends with all my life that are in the audience. You know, you started here. Where did you go?
Right.
There's a natural movement going up.
Mm-hmm.
We can trend that, and we can see where, like Travis said, where does the grass cutter go?
Right.
You know?
Mm-hmm.
And so I believe we're there with the benefits.
Yep.
I don't have a problem with the benefits. But we've got to look at a different mode. Mm-hmm. Of the way we work people and the structure of this company we call Ascension Parish.
Right.
And what's the options for the 24-year-old, the 18-year-old?
Right. Mm-hmm. Stay tuned till May. We're going to get there. Estelle
yeah.
is going to bring us a report.
That we have certain within the craft skills. We
right.
have certain craft skills of multiple ones that run in a certain range. We have another set of about three audibles out there that
mm-hmm.
he had mentioned that run up in another range.
Mm-hmm.
Because they are personal qualifications got to be done for them.
Right.
All right? And that's the ones over here. Maybe they choose not to do that. They like what they do.
That's right.
It's not a problem.
And that's
we
fine.
We need them also.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. That's right. And those are the kinds of options. You're exactly right.
Need to get the scales in,
mm-hmm.
and we need to get the evaluations
right
in place.
Right.
And I'm going to tell you what, we don't need to go out there and shock an employee that sat there and worked day and night and thinks he's been doing a great job for 20 years and find out, oh, you ain't worth the crap. You know
right.
what I mean? Look at
right.
this. You know?
Right.
We don't need that.
No.
Thank you, ma'am.
No. Thank you. Councilman Lawler.
Yes, thank you. I've got to get home soon and cut the grass, apparently.
they're cranking up the mower outside
yes.
for you. So.
I don't always dress like this. I had a baseball game to coach before this and couldn't finish it. A couple things. Councilman Clouard had some really good statements about merit raises. Maybe this is more for in a month from now, but a bell curve on it, is that something that we've looked at or that y'all have looked at? Not everybody can get a 5. And part of my concern is, and I've been through it myself, is if everybody gets the exact same raise, you have your high performers don't care anymore, and your low performers, they think, hey, I can keep on performing at a lower level. That's why I think merit raises are important, because it encourages both ends of the spectrum. Is that off base, or is that something
oh,
that we should be looking
no,
at?
No, I think you're absolutely right. And I think that what you've got to do is figure out where your culture is now and what is going to fit. And just like Councilman Clouard just said, radical changes are big surprises. I've been here 20 years. I thought I was doing a good job, and all of a sudden you have this piece of paper, and I'm not. That doesn't work. So I think we have to be somewhat realistic and to try and flip. We've had parish governments who wanted to flip from acting like a public organization to acting like private industry overnight, and it's just not going to work. Mm-hmm. It, there needs to be training of supervisors and the evaluators. All of that can really help. But I think something that we've seen that does work is sort of a standard merit that's a little bit smaller, and then something that could be applied for an outstanding performance that's, you know, set up ahead of time. Or there are ways of moving people a little more gradually into things like that. I'm just going to tell you that a lot of supervisors out there, if you force them to use a bell curve and they got a crew of seven guys, and those seven guys have been working together 15 years, 17 years, 20 years, there ain't no way they're going to do that. They would almost rather quit than, I'm going to choose one of these seven people. We've been working together. We're a team. I mean, we're a crew. I can tell you this one's better than that one, and that one's better than that one. But on any given day, I may have to rely on one more than the other. This one may be out. I just think you got to realize the reality of the situation. I do think that there are things that can be done, and you have some creative people and good people who I think can help design it. I just don't think Rome was built in a day. So no, I think you got to, yeah, you got to move into that.
When you say create, design it, would that be a human resources department?
Yes.
That's what we.
It would be.
This is a little more difficult. Retirement plans, you talked about them slipping into insolvency. Are there any, telltale signs that you would see, not necessarily in our system, that we should look for? And have you seen anything in our system that we need to keep an eye on that could be pushing us in that direction?
When we look at unfunded liability, that's one of the things that we ask about right away. And when they have, you know, an unbelievably high unfunded liability, it's just looming out there. It's just like a death sentence. You know it's coming. And the further an agency gets away from that, the longer, the more years there is that it's they're unable to fund it, the worse it gets. And so the debt payments, just like the federal government, right? So our debt payments just grow and grow and grow, and we can never catch up. You are so far from that. It's not an issue. So in East Baton Rouge Parish, for example, one of the things that they wanted to do, and I can't remember their unfunded liability, but you could probably find our report online and see it at the time, they wanted to try and reduce some of the benefit costs and then put that into funding their liability. You're going to see some bills in the legislature probably in the next couple of years where they're going to try and do that to the state system, because the payments are just, you know, going to keep growing at an astronomical rate. But again, we don't see anything that makes us worried at all. What you've been doing up until now has worked beautifully, and so if you stay the course, you should be fine. Where you would have a problem is if you had a chief executive officer like a governor or a parish president who came up with an idea to radically change something without having it tested to see, do I have enough people? If I stop using this and I have another alternative, do I have enough people to keep putting money in the system? Because all those retirees are going to keep drawing that money. We're getting older and older, and we live longer and longer. And so I got to make sure that I got enough people putting in things, and that's where the rub comes in. So if I say we're going to take that away, now everybody's got a portable 401k, that's great, or whatever LaFouche did. If I'm not careful and get those estimates really right, I take something that's laudable and twist it into something that's a problem. Again, you're not anywhere near there, but I'd be real careful if somebody came and tried to sell you some snake oil. I'd really ask Ms. LeBlanc to make sure she would look into that, because it could turn around.
Okay, good. And I'm glad to hear that. I'm glad that we're not in any danger of that. That means we've been doing a good job through the years, many
right.
years in a row. So I'm sure it doesn't just pop up overnight.
That's correct.
Long term.
That's correct. But it is a slippery slope once you start going the other way. So, yeah.
Good. To bring everybody into market range, this is not really for you, but it's $55,240.80. My thought is that is money that will have to come out of somewhere. And that is money that we can't use for other things, meaning that if we need a right-of-way acquisition to do some road work, it's going to have to come out of somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
So my next question is, is how much would we save if we brought the people that are making above the max? Because I know in the past year we've had people get increases of 32%, 16%, 20%. If we took people that were that in this past year given raises, really astronomical, quite honestly, and use some of that money and put that back to these people that are have been working and are working below the range, could that help cover that so that we do not have to pull money from other programs?
That would be the Robin Hood effect.
That would be the Robin Hood effect for those who did not hear. Very, very.
Yes, it would be, true. Probably.
Yeah, it would be, yeah.
You know what happened to him.
I do, but if you get a 32% raise in 1 year, that's an awful lot. I mean, is that common? To get a 32%, I don't know if anybody up here has gotten a 32% raise. Anybody? Oh, okay, other than, yeah. Councilman Turner, but hey, have you seen how he dresses? There you go.
But you're both attorneys, so I don't understand the difference.
Big difference.
I'm not sure we saw any 32% raises. We didn't see that. If somebody was promoted and into a new position, their pay may have changed.
But sometimes you can make a position is my concern. You make a position, put somebody in it.
That is true.
And all of a sudden you've got a massive raise. The problem is I don't want to take money that we can use, and we have a tight budget. You know, the parish is not just flowing with cash. These people deserve to be brought up. But when we see that there's people getting really astronomical raises in the past years, 12 months, 18 months, that's a concern.
I would say I would not describe that as a raise. I would describe that as a promotion that had a new pay scale associated with it. Again, we didn't look at whether people were qualified to be in the positions that they're in. In this part of the study.
That's the next study, correct?
But yes, but I would inquire from an employment attorney if somebody might not have grounds for a lawsuit if you just across the board or arbitrarily decide to cut some people's pay and not others, and if I was over 40 or female or male or different race or maybe had a disability, or I'm thinking that, you know, that's a can of worms. I just also think philosophically, if we put somebody in a position that they weren't qualified for and they got a massive amount of money, that's just wrong. That case is wrong. If we have 10 of those 10 cases are wrong. But some of these are just people who just were lucky enough. Maybe they hung around long enough and they had raises that went through the council and it kept them going. This is not the only organization that we have seen that is like this. It's actually, you know, a smaller percentage than in some other places. So I'd maybe do it a slightly different way if I was trying to find that $55,000.
Okay.
Instead of using reserves.
It's a serious concern of mine, and there are issues there. And I think in the past 18 months, we've had people's salaries get arbitrarily decreased. Mm-hmm. Now, maybe not arbitrarily, but they've been decreased by significant amounts. So it doesn't seem like that's a problem.
We'll certainly look into that. But I don't think we've run into that yet.
I think that's it for this meeting. I think a lot will come out of the next meeting. This is excellent information. Y'all have done an excellent job. Dr. Slaughter, your staff.
Great.
Thank you all.
We have good
this
guys.
Is extremely important. I think we'll be able to find the $55,000. Yeah. I think that's important.
Yeah, thank you. Good.
My turn?
I'm done.
Yes, indeed.
Thank you, Dr. Slaughter. We appreciate your report. I like your comparison to the cost of living versus merit.
Mm-hmm.
People get adjusted to a cost of living. They say, hey, doesn't matter what I do, I'm going to get the 2%, 3%, whatever it
is.
I'm very much in favor of merit raises, but that also incorporates and requires a very good performance evaluation.
Yes.
And it's a system that people just have to get trained in, get used to. So I'm looking forward to next month's report. Sitting at this end of the council, all the good questions get asked. And Benny and I are sitting over here saying, what are we going to talk about? But anyway, I'm looking forward to the May report for job descriptions as well as performance evaluations. And thank you.
Good. Thank
you
very much.
Job well done.
Thank you.
In May, I promise to start at the other end.
I'm done.
Okay.
Councilman Johnson.
So I guess one of the things you brought out earlier is starting people at, not necessarily at the bottom of the pay range, but somewhere in the middle. Is there some standard for establishing credit for experience or training that they bring to the job?
Yes, sir.
You can justify starting them at that rate.
Yes. Oftentimes what we'll see is a policy where there will be a range, maybe 15% above minimum to X range, maybe even up, you know, getting closer to the midpoint. But going beyond that, it would take some justification of unique experience, training, something, as you just mentioned, that would push somebody into a higher level on the range. And, you know, sometimes you're lucky enough to get somebody like that, and you need to match that salary. But again, they're pretty good guidelines and a process. So it's not just arbitrary. Well, gee, I think Mr. Johnson should have that, but I don't think Mr. Cagnolotti qualifies. It shouldn't be arbitrary.
So along those lines, are y'all, going back, I'm trying to remember the gist of the RFQ, are y'all going to be helping us to establish those types of guidelines?
Yes, sir, we will make some recommendations on that, absolutely.
So one of the other things that was bounced around with some of the previous questions was when you start talking about merit-based raises and getting into the employee reviews and those types of things, one of the questions I don't think was answered was from where we are today in order to get to that, and how much of a time frame or how long of a time frame do you think we should take, or would it take us to get to that point?
To get to where you had a form, a system and processes
system
and trained
right.
supervisors, yeah. Takes about 60 to 90 days at most.
At most, okay.
Unless you want a lot of review in a complicated form and every single job is going to have some uniqueness to it, but to have a good, solid, cut your teeth on performance appraisal form system, and you've had things. It's just not consistent. And but I do, as several council members have said, the training is imperative, and then having human resources staff who can work with directors, managers, supervisors to make sure that it's consistent and being applied appropriately is important too.
So with the job descriptions that are there, how far are we away from having some type of measurable form, whether it's a grass cutter or whoever, that says, okay, as a supervisor, when I'm sitting here across from this employee doing a performance review, I have actual measurables that I can sit there and say, okay, you do this well or you don't do this so well kind of thing. So where are we at with that?
You know, I would say if there was a significant sense of urgency about it, that 90 days is really realistic. 60 days is aggressive. But I think in a quarter you can get there, because you have to have some design team of people from the president's office, administration, and some department directors from a variety of different kinds of departments, different kinds of jobs. Who look over that, make suggestions. They've got to reach consensus, work with human resources, and then that form is developed and rolled out, and people are trained on it, and employees receive communications about what's going to happen. And then you begin, and then you can decide, do I want to do everybody at a certain date? Do I want to do it by anniversary? Do I want to do a third of my employees? What's, you know, how many people do our supervisors supervise? How many would they have to do at one time? But honestly, those are not hard decisions. Our clients lose a lot of time if they decide that every single person in the parish gets to weigh in on those decisions. But if you have some clarity and people who have done this before, and you do, you have a lot of department directors who are anxious to get something like that in place and have a lot of experience in former lives and can contribute to it. So it shouldn't take that long.
So last question in a different area. So typically with the cost of living increase, it's across the board. Do normally the salary ranges move up? If I give a 2% cost of living raise, does the bottom and everything basically move up by 2%?
Everything does.
So basically the cost of living raise that we've done, when we haven't increased those salary ranges, that's where we've gotten out of whack. Where a lot of these guys that are above the salary range got there because we didn't raise the range up when we did a cost of living raise.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
Thank you. I don't think there's any need for a second round unless... There we go. This O.J. passed to the end. Councilman Joseph.
Ben, I didn't want you to be last, man.
Sure, right. Yeah.
Christelle, once again, thanks for the report. Great report. If I was anybody listening to us, I would want to work for Ascension Parish.
Yes, I would too.
Okay.
So would my staff.
You know, sitting here and being part of the political roundtable here, you know, we hear a lot, just like the grass cutter over there said that a 30% increase in salary. They do not know all the story behind everything. But your report just basically saying we're right there with the market.
Mm-hmm.
And that is, you know, I'm going to be honest with you, it's hard for me to believe, okay? Because some of them do get paid more than what I think they should get paid. That's me personally, though. But what it is, it is. And I want to commend you on. The only thing I have a question is, that everybody asks the same question. Do you think with our system we have right here that you find that we had the like of new technology to keep up with some of the stuff that you want us to do as far as evaluation, records, out process evaluation and all that. That data is very important for this government to know what direction we need to go in the future.
Right.
And right now, from everything I've seen and dealing with employees that have been through our process, we get a piece of paper. And one piece of paper might be from 1990,
right?
2000. So your recommendation that we need to bring ourselves up to date with new technology?
Yes, absolutely. And your ERP system, I think, is going to do a lot to get you there. I think it's going to be painful for your folks to go through the implementation. I think, you know, Jones area, Gwen's area, I mean, they're... Human resources, they're gonna suffer through it. But I think the end product will result in a great database. Somebody asks a question, what percentage of people can retire in the next 5 years? It doesn't take somebody combing through or going to another system and double-checking. I'm just going to be honest with you. We had a hard time figuring out how many employees you have. It's nobody's fault. And that's true generally in places because... You got data 4 months into the study, and then, you know, you got another set of data, and it doesn't necessarily match. But it's really hard here, and it's really paper-intensive, and it puts a burden on your employees because of that. So I definitely think that you need to move forward. And there's some tag-on software to some of the new systems that you're going to bring in. And I think those investments are really worth it. They're not necessarily as expensive as your ERP system is going to be.
Okay, no. Well, Chair, if you don't mind, I would make a recommendation. We accept this report and take the 7 recommendation on consideration. And and 100% on number 2.
I'll second that.
That's the pay set.
Have a motion and a second. Any objections? Any questions? Hearing none, that motion passes. Christelle?
I got a quick question before she leaves.
Before you leave. Randy has a question, but I'll be quick. Oh,
I'm going to be back in May with bulletproof vests, so I'm okay. I'll absolutely.
Well, actually, yes, within the umbrella of the parish and parish government, and this same board, all except Councilman Oliver Joseph, we sit on the East Ascension Gravity Drainage District, and which is in part a different part of money. Mm-hmm. I would like to see that what we're doing here for parish-wide workers is those workers cross paths every day, share jobs, do things, that we make sure that we carry whatever we recommend and go forward.
That's a good suggestion.
With that department also. And OJ agrees with that within his motion. Yeah.
But that's all 407 workers already.
I think they're
that's across
in
the board.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yeah.
Thank you.
Good. Yeah, sure. Thank you. Good observation.
All right.
Councilwoman, thank you so much.
Thank
Council members,
you so much.
Well, we'll see you in a few weeks.
We appreciate everything that you've done.
Absolutely.
See you
thank
back
you
soon.
All.
Anita, thank you. Okay, let's get back to the meat of our agenda. Item number 7. Renewal of a contract with Roberto Macedo and Associates. Ms. Martha.
Thank you, Madam Chairman, members of the council. This is a renewal for Roberto Macedo's. He is contracted to do the administration for Section 8. He's been with us for a while, and I'm just going to stop right here and say, Councilman Joseph, I've already put a call in to Mr. Roberto, and he will be more than happy to come to the next meeting or whenever we can do it to give an update.
Now, he has done that every year.
He does it every year,
and,
but
and we appreciate
but Councilman Joseph always has to make sure that I remember that, but I beat him this year.
Motion.
I have a motion by Councilman Satterley.
Second.
Second by Councilman Cagnolotti to approve. Any questions? Any objections? Hearing none, that motion passes. Item
thank
number
you.
8, the Certificate of Substantial Completion, Roger Cluot Park, a.k.a. Santa Ballpark Lighting Project, Ricky DeArmond. Recreation
yes.
Director. Thank you, Ricky.
Thank y'all for allowing me to be here. I'm here to ask for substantial completion on a lighting project. It was an electrical project, Roger Cluart Park. And what it was is this was all damage that was caused from the flood because our electrical boxes stayed underwater for 6 days.
Is it substantially
motion.
Complete?
Yes, ma'am.
Good deal.
Motion.
A motion by Councilman Randy Cluart and a second by Councilman Cagnolotti. Any questions? Any objections? Hearing none, that motion passes. We pass on item number 9. Item number 10, renewal of the contract with Curtis Environmental for analytical testing, contract amount not to exceed $8,500. Carl?
Ladmoreau.
Ladmoreau.
Thank you.
You have to spell that with an E-A-U-X and I'll have
it.
Carl Ladmoreau, operations manages utilities.
Okay, this is a contract with Curtis Environmental to do our compliance testing on 9 facilities.
So moved.
Second.
I have a motion by Councilman Joseph, second by Councilman Johnson. Any questions? Any objections? Hearing none, that motion passes.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Item number 11, amendment to number 1 to the professional services contract between Charles Albert and Ascension Parish Government to include Ascension Fire District number 2, and their additional scope of work, which will increase the total amount of the original contract by an additional $3,600 for a total not to exceed the amount of $11,200. Mr. McDonald, Fire Chief,
yes.
Fire District Number 2.
Fire Welcome, District sir. Number 2 just like to be added to the contract.
So moved.
Second.
I have a motion by Councilman Joseph, second by Councilman Johnson. Any questions of the Fire Chief? Any objections? Hearing none, that motion passes.
Thank you, sir.
Item number 12, a resolution for transportation bonds. Mr. Malcolm Dugas.
Good evening.
Good evening, sir. Welcome, Jim.
Thank you. We were asked by the administration, I think, through Bill Rue to run some numbers on some transportation bonds. There were some bonds that were paid off in November, and Bill had talked with Jim and I and also Marcus about possibly doing some other projects. So I have prepared a resolution for the committee's consideration. And this resolution, I think you should have a copy of it in front of you, sets some ceilings of outside parameters on what this would allow the parish to do with regards to future transportation projects. It would authorize the issuance of not to exceed $25 million in revenue bonds to be paid back in not to exceed 20 years. Right now, the market is good. Bond rates, and Jim will talk to you about this, in the mid threes, but the market is going up. So now is a good time to get this process started. We have prepared a timeline, and that timeline shows that if we started this process now, because of all of the hoops that need to be jumped through, we wouldn't conclude this process until August, beginning of August, would be the closing date as far as being able to access any funds.
Move to adopt.
I'll second.
Motion to adopt by Councilman Dawson, second by Councilman Lawler. Any questions?
Real quick.
Councilman Kluwat.
I just want to make clear, Malcolm, you or Jim can make it clear that we're starting this process. Should we make any changes in between? We're not hellbound at the end.
That's absolutely correct, Mr. Kluwat. This is basically a parameter resolution, and as long as we play within that parameter, we're fine, and you don't have to do anything if you don't want to. You're not obligated to do anything at all. This just sets up the paperwork. As I always make the analogy, this is like filling out the home loan application. So that if you want to go house shopping, you're pre-approved, and you can say, I lock in the rate today rather than finding the house and then spending 3 months at the bank, and interest rates are going up 0.5% in that 3 months.
But being proactive, we get it in front of the bond commission.
You got it.
Thank you.
Okay. Any other questions? Mr. Joseph.
And Malcolm, we have done this before. I know we have.
Yes, we
so
have.
So this is nothing unusual.
It is not. It is not.
Correct.
Actually, as I said earlier, we had done this, and we just, as of November, had paid off the prior bond issue.
So I have a motion, a second. Any further questions? Any objections? Hearing none, that motion passes.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Item number 13, the monthly contract report. Ms. Sandra.
Good evening. You have before you the list of contracts and agreements that we entered into in the month of March. I'll let you look over it. If you have any questions, I'll be glad to answer.
Any questions, gentlemen? Hearing none, Ms.
One question.
Well, there we go. Mr. Joseph?
Hey, the dental service for the inmate, we paying that kind of money for them?
We have been for a while. We only pull teeth, and we pull a lot. Up to $30,000 we've been spending. This is last few years.
Okay. I'm going to jail to get my dental work.
All we do is pull.
It might not be worth it. Might have to come in. You can't get your dental work done.
Thank you. That's all I had.
Thank you so much.
All right. Thank you.
Item number 14, the 2017 millage review of ordinance process by Ms. Gwynn. Thank you, Madam Chairman. You have before you your little pamphlet for the review of the 2017 millage process. Louisiana law requires that all tax recipients of ad valorem taxes to adopt an ordinance each year so that the millage rates can be applied to the assessed value of properties. The Louisiana Constitution requires all properties subject to taxation to be reappraised and valued at least once every 4 years. 2016, as you recall, was a reassessment year. And the council, sitting as the governing authority, has two main functions to fulfill in this process. First, you have to adopt the millage for the parish government, and then in the early fall, you will sit as a board of review to adopt the Ascension Parish assessment role as presented by the assessor, which includes all of the taxing districts in the parish. So, therefore, this process begins in April and ends with the acceptance of the tax roll by the Louisiana Tax Commission in November of each year. We would like to present at your next council meeting the announcements that is required, and also they present the ordinances for introduction in order to schedule the appropriate public notices and public hearings and the adoption of the ordinances. You're pretty familiar with the little pamphlet. Page one is just procedures that you would have to go through. Page two, it gives you some information about all your taxing districts that you would be adopting and the expiration date of each. And about almost three-fourths of the way down, if you look at East Ascension Gravity Drainage District, their tax expires in 2018. As well as on page three, the road lighting district number four, the parcel fee expires in 2018. All of our millages are 10 years except the constitutional millage for the general fund. The utilities district number one, ACUD number one, is for 25 years, and the juvenile detention center is for 20 years. And there's some little few facts that you can read that you're probably familiar with. And on page four is ordinance number one, where you adopt your 2017 millage. And on page six is ordinance number two, where you would adopt the 17 millage. You would bring forward this 2017 millage and then roll forward to the 2017 levy. And then on page eight, it's just a chart depicting all the taxing districts of the property, of the parish. The property taxes are ad valorem taxes, 29.6 million. And then on page nine, it's all the taxing districts in the entire parish. And that's it's based on 2016. Naturally, that's the latest figures we have, as we haven't done 2017 yet. And parish-wide, with all the parish taxing districts, $127.2 million is collected. And then on page 10 is just the process you go through to sit as a board of review. And then 11 through the end is the recap of the laws that affect the process. So at this time, we had asked that you put it on your next agenda, the announcement only, and the introduction of ordinances, so that we could establish our appropriate public notices and public hearings, and then schedule the adoption of the ordinances. Thank you, ma'am. That will be done. Mr. Dawson?
Mr. Blount, didn't we just go, we went through this last year?
Yes, we did, and it was challenged by the legislative auditor. And I'm sure Mr. O'Neill could probably give you
Is that why we're having to do it again?
Yes. We have appealed that, and we have an argument this month. But because we split it on two nights, the legislative auditor challenged it. We voted on one on one night and one the second.
It was a technicality. They countered, I think, O'Neill, that it, the word process was a total of both of them, not splitting, voting on one ordinance one meeting and one ordinance.
So do we have time for that appeal to play out? Or not?
Well, if it does, we would cancel out.
We have an argument on April 20th. We can always cancel, but to be safe, we move this forward.
Okay.
Because even when the Court of Appeal, after they hear the argument, then they can take it under advisement, and we don't know if the legislative auditor will go to the Supreme Court or not.
You're on day.
So we move to introduce.
I'll make a motion to adopt recommendation.
Second.
Have a motion and a second to adopt the recommendations. Any questions? Any objections? Hearing none, that motion passes. Thank you. Item number 15, a budget amendment. A approval to introduce ordinance to amend 2017 budget. Dawn Cavalier.
Good evening. You have before you the ordinance for budget amendment number one, which reads as follows. An ordinance to amend the ordinance approving, adopting, and appropriating the 2017 operating and capital budgets for the Parish of Ascension, adopted by the Ascension Parish Council on the 17th day of November, 2016. Section 1. The Ascension Parish Council hereby ordains that the ordinance approving, adopting, and appropriating the 2017 operating and capital budgets for the Parish of Ascension is hereby amended, approved, and appropriated as follows. Operating budget, Fire District Number 1, expenditures. Operating supplies, $100,000. Acquisitions, vehicles and equipment, $50,000. Acquisitions, lands and buildings, $133,000, and this is to purchase lot and improvements next to Station 62. Contract payments for $300,000 for renovations to Stations 50, 62, and 80 due to flood damage. Capital budget. Please note that all of the construction projects listed below were budgeted to be completed in 2016. However, these projects are now projected to be completed in 2017, and the budgets are being amended as follows. Office Building Construction Fund, DPW East Building, expenditures, architect and landscape services, $3,500, contract payments, $203,000. Water Wastewater Construction Fund for the Louisiana 42 Sewer Project, expenditures, engineering fees, $25,000, contract payments, $545,500. Fire District Number 3, Construction Fund for Fire Station Number 34, expenditures, professional services, $28,000, contract payments, $623,500. Community Development Block Grant Fund, expenditures, CDBG Housing Rehabilitation, $174,000. Hazard Mitigation Grant Fund for the project for Lamar Dixon Improvements, Task 1 and 2, expenditures, appropriations, and grants, $900,000. CDBG Construction Fund for the project Lamar Dixon Improvements, Task 1. Expenditures, CDBG Lamar Dixon Improvements, $198,000. Park Construction Fund for projects Lamar Dixon Gym Renovations, Lamar Dixon Soccer Complex, the sign in Donisonville, and the field pole lighting project. Expenditures, appropriations, and grants, $294,000. Contract payments, $1,618,000. $618,500.
Move to approve the introduction.
Second.
I have a motion and a second to approve. Any questions? Hearing none. Any objections? Hearing none, that motion passes. Item number 16, the sales and use tax report.
Thank you. You have before you your regular report. This is based on the collections that were for the month of February based on January sales. You can see that all three of your districts, especially the month-to-month comparison, is way up, and that was mainly due to a large audit that was completed in February of 2017. It also, there was an increase in motor vehicles that we still continue to realize. And overall, the plants are down due to the completion of the major construction project on the east west side of the river. So that accounts for the increase in East Ascension drainage higher than the other two. The budget comparisons at 16.66% of the year, you can see that they are all collections are above budget. Hopefully they stay that way. And on page 2, you have your bar chart that you're familiar with and the pie chart on the next page and then the historical chart.
Any questions, gentlemen? I don't see any, Ms. Wynn. Thank you very much for that report. Item number 17, the Revenue and Expenditure Report. Ms. Amanda.
Good evening. Before you are the financial reports for the month of February 2017. Page 1, revenues are at 10.23%. Page 2, expenditures are at 23.40% at 16.66% of the year. Page 3, are charts that compare the year-to-date revenue and expenditures for both operating and capital to the budget. Page 4 and 5 gives a brief explanation of the funds that are highlighted on page 1 and 2 that are under the budget for revenues or over the budget for expenditures by 5% or more. And the last page reflects all checks issued in February over $100,000, and the total of those checks were $7,797,029.24. And once you review the report, if you have any questions, I'll be happy to answer.
Gentlemen, does anyone have any questions? Hearing no questions, we'll move along to item number 18, the bid items. To accept the lowest responsive bid, Ms. Jones.
On March 7, 2017, the purchasing department received one bid for a Moore Max 30-foot boom mower with 60-inch deck. After review, the purchasing department and DPW recommend accepting the lowest responsive bid from Covington Sales and Services and to authorize the parish president to enter into any applicable agreement or contract for this equipment.
I have a motion by Councilman Dempsey Lambert.
Second.
Second by Councilman Randy Kluwat. Any questions? Any objections? Hearing none, that motion passes.
On March 29, 2017, the purchasing department received three quotes for the construction for the pavilion at Keystone Park. After review, the purchasing department and the recreation department recommend accepting the lowest responsive quote submitted by Gitro General Contractors and to authorize the parish president to enter into any applicable agreement or contract for this service.
Have a motion by Councilman Dempsey Lambert.
Second.
Second by Councilman John Cagnolotti. Any questions? Any objections? Hearing none, that motion passes.
On March 16, 2017, the purchasing department received three quotes for the renovation and their addendum number one for the Santa Ma substation number 62. After review, the purchasing department and fire district number one recommend accepting the lowest responsive quote submitted by Southern Custom Builders. Motion. And to authorize the parish president to enter into any applicable agreement or contract for this service.
Have a motion by Councilman second. Randy Kluwat, a second by Councilman Aaron Lawler. Any questions?
Yes, ma'am, real quick.
Yes.
We have Chief James LeBron. James, can you come quick and give us a little update on the fire station?
This is what you're talking about tonight is just the remodeling of the fire station on Highway 431, mm-hmm. which will be the only fire station in Santa Ma that we're actually remodeling. The rest of them will be tore down completely and rebuilt. So this is going to be the home of the main station for the next 2 to 3 years on Highway 431 next to Lake Middle School.
Right.
You need any update on any other ones?
What you got on the other
Geismar's building? Geismar's being rebuilt totally. Sorrento's being rebuilt on John LeBlanc Boulevard.
Right.
Galvez Lake's being completely remodeled. Santa Ma's 62 being remodeled. Santa Ma main station, Highway 22, is being tore down, totally rebuilt. Galvez Lake substation on 931 and 431 is being tore down and rebuilt.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Okay.
Thank you, Chief. Any other questions? Any objections? Hearing none, that motion passes. The chair would entertain a motion to adjourn.
Second. So moved.
Have a motion by Councilman Cagnolotti and a second by Councilman Lambert. We are adjourned.